I
lift up my
eyes
to
the
hills.
From
where
does
my
help come?
My
help
comes
from
the
Lord
who
made
heaven
and
earth.
Psalm
121,
1 through 2. Worship inspired by Psalm 23.
In the darkest valley,
at the banquet table,
in the hard work of life,
at the moment of ease,
in our day-to-day reality,
at times set aside,
like this time now,
for worship, for listening, for paying attention.
With every step we take,
goodness and mercy follow us, our cups overflow.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than beyond belief. I raise a
louder. Sing a little louder. Sing a little louder. Good morning. Hope all of you are well and safe this morning. Today I brought something with me that I really cherish and I think is so pretty. It's my pearl necklace. Every single one of these pearls were made in a special way. Pearls come from an animal called an oyster. And an oyster lives in the ocean. And an oyster is covered by a really hard shell. Well, that shell is to protect it. But sometimes a grain of sand will get into that shell. And when it does, it causes the oyster a lot of pain. It's very painful to it. So God made a way that the oyster could help get rid of some of that pain. The oyster has a liquid that it oozes out over the grain of sand. And as it covers the grain of sand, it hardens. And the oyster keeps oozing the liquid until the pain goes away. And what's left is a pearl. And people will find oysters and they will get the pearls from the oyster and they make jewelry and other beautiful things. And you know, our life is like that sometimes too. Sometimes we're going to have pain and suffering. And we all want a way to get rid of the pain and suffering. Well, God has provided us a way. We pray to God, we ask for His help, and He oozes His love out over us. And this love that God gives us will help us to get rid of the pain and suffering and be able to deal with everything that comes up in our lives. And even from that, something beautiful could happen. Maybe we could love God enough that we go out and we ooze our love out among those that we know and tell them where we got that love. We got it from God. Let's bow our heads. Dear Lord, thank you for these wonderful boys and girls. Help them to know they will have times of pain and sorrow, but God is there to help them. His love will help them with whatever they go through in life. Amen.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not, as thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter, and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings are mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Here a reading from the prophet Isaiah, the 40th chapter, beginning in the 28th verse. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is an everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and grow weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me and for me now? O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter in every storm of life, and our eternal home, we pause and give you thanks for the gifts of this day. We ask, O God, that you would watch over us, that you would strengthen us in the weak places, and that you would lead us onward in the face of this new year. Show us what we need to know, and give us ears to hear. For this is our prayer. In the very strong name of Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen. It was the best of times. It was the worst of times. It was the age of wisdom. It was the age of incredulity. It was the epoch of belief. It was the age of foolishness. It was the season of light. It was the season of darkness. It was the spring of hope. It was the winter of despair. No doubt you recognize these words from Charles Dickens' A Tale of Two Cities. This is the best of times because we have learned how to navigate the unusual spaces of COVID-19. It seems like it's the worst of times because this global pandemic has disrupted and disoriented us. And frankly, it and the events of our day have pushed us to our limits of coping. For those of us who consider ourselves to be baby boomers and younger, we have not known this kind of unevenness in our lifetime. And for many, it has been exhausting. I listen to my children who have 2 5-year-olds. My son and my daughter both have 5-year-olds attempting to do kindergarten virtually. They are exhausted. I listen to healthcare workers who have made enormous adjustments and have been essential workers on the front lines. They too are weary. I listen to my friends in higher education who have had to navigate the college environment, and they are worn out. I listen to our pastors, and I give thanks to God that you have allowed them this day to take some space and allow me to come to your sanctuaries with this sermon, because believe me, our pastors too are worn out. I listen to children whose parents or grandparents are in nursing care facilities and worry, and the worry and frustration they have to be distanced from their loved ones. In our own family, we had to do the window visit during the holidays with Lynn's mother, who was in rehab. I listen to our black and brown brothers and sisters who are experiencing a dual pandemic of COVID-19 and systemic racism. And they are afraid, and they are tired, they are weary. We pray, how long, O Lord, must we be strangers in a strange land? How long will it be before we can return to some sense of normalcy? We hope against hope that the vaccine is going to do the trick, but it's going to take a while. How long to just go and simply sit on the ocean side and listen to the waves crash and experience God's good creation. We're living in a disrupted time. Some call it a liminal space. The Celtics called it a thin place, a place between what was and what is to come. Can those of you who are parents remember your life before children? Well, I know that's a stretch for some of us, but I remember watching, especially my son and daughter-in-law, as they prepared for the adoption of their first child. The anxiety, the fear, the anticipation. They did not know what they did not know. And then in the middle of the day in August, 9 years ago, the call came, come to Utah, the baby is on the way. And the weariness of that transition when it looked like at one point the adoption was going to fall through, the weariness of coming home with a newborn on an airplane, the weariness of becoming parents without the normal anticipation of pregnancy, the weariness of Millie, my daughter-in-law, when her company would not grant her the normal maternity leave for an adoption. Parenting, even in the best of circumstances, is exhausting. I told them to just wait. One day this child will be 16 and you will have an entirely different kind of weariness. Well, those of us of sufficient years know that life is not always the beach and a bag of chips. And when life comes crashing in on us, when illness or death or defeat comes without warning, you begin to feel as if you're walking in the wilderness. And sometimes the wilderness can look like the very place in which you live. Or maybe it feels like exile, which is a place from which the prophet speaks this word from Isaiah. You know this to be true. Exile is no stranger to this season of our world. In 2020, 2021, we very much feel as though we have been in exile. In our text today, Isaiah is responding to his friends and loved ones out of the challenge of the years in the Babylonian exile. It's as if the Israelites were crying out, "How long, O Lord, how long will we be strangers in a strange land?" It echoes Psalm 137, "By the rivers of Babylon, we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion. There on the poplars, we hung up our harps because our captors demanded of us songs." For more than 40 years, the congregation had waited for their plight to change. The prophet is trying to strengthen the congregation to remind them who and whose they were. And it's in this strange place. If you stay in this strange place too long and you start talking and looking different and you start worshiping foreign gods. Some of you know a few years ago I was in the Holy Land and I tripped and I fell in one of Herod's palaces in Palestine and broke two ribs. I could not catch my breath for what seemed like an eternity. I thought I was dying. I thought I was just at the end of my rope. Maybe you haven't fallen like that, but I suspect that those of us of sufficient years have had an experience or two where life has knocked the wind out of us and thrust us into a kind of exile where we feel as if we are strangers in a strange land. Maybe that's where you are today. It's when the patient learns that cancer has metastasized and the doctor says we've done all we can do. It's when every available resource has been exhausted, every marker called in, and the moment one realizes that bankruptcy is unavoidable. Sooner or later, we all end up east of Eden, as John Steinbeck's book was titled. And when you're in exile, it's important to remember the way the biblical narrative helps us remember is by telling the story. Isaiah is clever to echo and rehearse the narrative of what God has done. So here in verse 21, we hear, "Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth?" If you translate the Hebrew text, it actually reads, "Have you not understood the foundations of the earth?" So this rhetorical question is actually the climax in a short series of staccato lines. Surely you know. Surely you have heard. Surely it has been told you. Surely you understand the foundations of the earth. And if you understand the foundations of the earth, how can you believe the possibility of any other God at work in our world? This God alone stands above the world, creating a place for those who are like grasshoppers to live. And in spite of what may often feel like the absence of the presence of God, God is intimately involved in our lives. This last section, verses 27 through 31, is perhaps the most well-known portion of Scripture, arguably the most prone to misinterpretation. Occasionally, the language of verse 30 concerning those who are weary and exhausted is isolated and used pastorally for those who are in difficult circumstances. And while there is little doubt that God is very much concerned about those who are weary and exhausted, the verses have a more pointed focus. Verse 27 aids in our interpretation. And here the poet quotes lamenting, asking, "Why do you say my way is hidden from the Lord and my right is disregarded by my God?" Why do you say that? The Message translation says it this way: God has lost track of me. He doesn't care what happens to me. The weary are exhausted, and those who have felt abandoned by their God and their circumstances do little to deny such a thought. Well, the poet doesn't deny such weariness, but instead suggests that such weariness does not deny God. The God of Israel is the everlasting God and the creator of the ends of the earth. This God is the only one who created, but he not only created, but he creates. The promise of an end to exile and renewed strength seems impossible to the believer because their current plight is so impossible to deny. And what seems irreconcilable is in fact not, because of the identity of the one in whom they confess. While his understanding is unsearchable, his identity undeniable, he is the creator who recreates, shaping and reshaping the world and all who live in it. God creates the tension. God separates light from dark, heaven from earth, perfection from sin, paradise from humanity. In a way, God sets up this dynamic interaction, establishing relationship, instituting an ongoing tension, and further instigates it with God's ongoing creative, redemptive work. Now, here's what I'm trying to say today. Our story suggests we wait and we watch so we can begin to see what God is doing next. This is what the prophet Isaiah was trying to convey to the Hebrew people in exile. Remember, God's not gone or dead or leaving us alone. So align yourself with God, attune yourself to what God is doing, and rediscover the emerging opportunities. As I like to say, God's got you, has always had you, and will always have you. God's understanding is unsearchable. God keeps looking for us even when we feel abandoned, reshaping. God continually making us into something better, a new people. His identity undeniable. He is creator and sustainer, redeemer and friend. And already God is recreating, shaping, and reshaping our world. So if you find yourself in exile, now or sometime in the future, know this. The good news of the gospel, which Isaiah is foretelling, is that Jesus offers us a different way of knowing. I've been helped in recent days by the writing of Franciscan priest Richard Rohr. Rohr writes, "Jesus offers an intimate relationship, sometimes a dark night of the soul, a path where we must discover for ourselves that grace, love, and mercy and forgiveness are absolutely necessary for survival in this uncertain world of ours." And friends, have we not had some uncertainty in recent days? Know this: you only need enough clarity and ground to take your next faithful step. Paul was right. We really are saved by faith, not by certainty. And if you will commit your life to this journey to live in this way, you will never stop growing. You will not easily be defeated. And frankly, life is a whole lot more fun. Now, here's the truth. You can tell mature, authentic faith by people's ability to deal with darkness and failure and brokenness, and by their quiet but confident joy. One of the early church mothers, Mother Synlectia, died in 400 AD, wrote this. We sail on in darkness, confident in Isaiah's reminder that our way is never hidden from a God who is infinite in his understanding and unconditional in his love. I like to believe that I'm a lifelong learner. And let me tell you what I've been learning lately. I've been learning not to give up and to keep trusting in God's grace. That the more you mature, the wiser you become regarding your own fault lines. We are, concluded Cassia, not angels, but only human beings. And yet God is still creating. In our family, since I came among you 9 years ago now, our tribe has increased from 1 to 5 grandchildren. And I've got pictures if you're interested. As I said earlier, our grandson Thomas is adopted, and when he was 1, I was elected bishop, so he's grown up with me in this work. When he was a toddler and learning to talk, he learned to say Papa before he learned to say Gran. Of course, I love that. Sometimes he would call Grandpapa, and sometimes when he said it, it was a cry for help. Sometimes it was a praise. At other times, it was a joy. What new life teaches us is that God is still creating, and it teaches first-time parents faith. It's this virtual learning world and much faith. Not only is God still creating, God is still calling. God is calling, creating, and God is still renewing. Not long ago, I sat with a friend of mine who's been successful in the business world and in the world of politics, if you can believe that. He said to me, I've been evaluating my life. I'm ready to make some changes. I think we're going to downsize our house so we won't be so chained to a mortgage. I think God's been renewing my faith these last years. It started when I decided somebody needed to teach Bible to our Sunday school class. And, well, you know what happens when you volunteer or make a suggestion, you get to do the teaching. And so there I was, having to prepare every week to teach. And it forced me to take the Bible very seriously. And it, frankly, has changed my life. And then he said this. If you need anybody to fill a pulpit anywhere, I'm willing. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't feel called to preach, but I do feel called to share with other lay folk that I've been changed. I've been renewed. I've been redeemed. Friends, God is still redeeming. We see this every time a person broken by sin and failure turns away from destructive habits and allows the Holy Spirit to renew and they start again. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is an everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. Many years ago, when I was a pastor, a church called Philadelphia, Mississippi, Philadelphia First Church, I was weary. And back in the day when we used to have Sunday night church, you remember Sunday night church? I stood before my congregation and I wept. I was exhausted. I was exhausted from the work. I was exhausted from the stress and strain of trying to lead a church. My children were small and they were demanding. And out of nowhere, tears fell from my eyes. By the grace of God, I went to the altar and knelt and prayed. And 2 or 3 of the leaders came and laid hands on me and prayed with me. And when I rose from that altar, I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that God was with me. And it was enough. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Remember that you do not go alone. God is close at hand. God hears the cry of all who call his name. He honors those who honor him, listening to their prayers and coming to their aid. So go from this time with joy and confidence to love and serve God and one another. And all God's people said, Amen.